Good morning. I'm Debbie Nelson, just so you don't get confused. And so I'm really delighted to be here. Bonnie has long been an intellectual hero of mine. And so I thought, though, what first occurred to me when I was asked to do this event was, well, how does a political theorist come to take up the Sabbath as an object of study? And I just wanted to know a little bit about your path and where this comes from in your work, and then we can talk about where it goes.
Okay, great. Well, hi, everyone, and thanks for coming out on a Saturday morning. I was thinking, who's going to come here about Sabbath on a Saturday morning? If you're interested, you're in synagogue, and then otherwise you're not interested. But apparently, like me, there are a lot of people like me, which is great. So thanks for coming out. I got started, well, there are two things that started me off thinking about this topic. The first one is just the moment that we're living in, or at least we're living in until Tuesday, which was very defined by concerns about the 24/7 temporality and the kind of non-stopness of modern life. And I noticed there had been a couple of books and articles written by people like Judith Shulevitz's book, The Sabbath World. Andrew Sullivan recently wrote a piece for The New Yorker about the Sabbath and saying that it would be a great idea to have a digital Sabbath where you just like turn everything off for 24 hours once a week. And so I had written in the 1990s, early aughts, about the slow food movement as a kind of alternative to fast food. And I started thinking, oh, there's like a slow time movement now, people trying to figure out a way to stop the overly fast pace that we, and non-stopness, as I said. So that started, you know, that was part, I think, of the kind of ambient background idea. And then the next part is a bit circuitous or quirky, maybe, but one of the things I work on is the political theory of Hannah Arendt. And I was reading an essay of hers called The Jew as Pariah, in which she talks about the dilemma faced by minority populations of how to claim membership in a majority society that treats them as minorities. And she distinguishes between the pariah option and the parvenu option. The parvenu is assimilationism, and which is sort of erasure of self and just membership. And the other one is pariah, which is accepting your minoritized status and not really trying to claim membership at all. And she likes this third option called the conscious pariah, in which you own your difference. You don't try to hide it, but you also find a way to claim membership through your difference. So I told you it's circuitous. It is. her first example, so then the essay has four examples of people who take this conscious pariah route. The first example that she gives is the poet Heinrich Heine. I actually brought you a picture. Let's see if I remember what I'm supposed to do. No, I don't. Yes, I do. There. Okay, well, that's most of him. And he wrote a poem, and the example, it's not just that he wrote a poem, but the example that she gives of his successful negotiation of the not pariah, not parvenu problematic.
And what era did Heine live?
Oh, I can't see it. 1797. Okay. That's why I put it there, because I would have been like, huh, I'm not sure. 1797, 1856. And so the poetry that she chooses as exemplary of this choice is the Sabbath poetry. It's a series of poems. One of them in particular she loves is called Princess Sabbath. And what she loves about that poem is that he takes the dish of Sabbath, which is called Cholent in Yiddish, Shalet in German, and he talks about how beautiful a dish it is, how wonderful, how aromatic, how delicious. It's a kind of low stew. You know, you can make it with a little meat if you're poor. You can make it with a lot of meat if you're rich. It's a kind of just very low kind of food in a way. But it's a Sabbath food because you can put it on the stove on Friday night and it can stew along all Saturday and you can eat it hot. And maybe that's all much more than you need to know. What he does is he writes this poem in which he's extolling the virtues of cholent, and he says it's like the nectar and ambrosia of the Greek gods. In fact, I took a little bit of it here so you could see it. how both overwrought his description is. He associates it with the Greek immortal gods. And he says it's on their tables with their nectar and ambrosia. And she finds this audacious for a Jewish poet living in Germany under, you know, the requirement of assimilation to write. And the Germans are very Grecophilic in this period. And so to be German means to love the ancient Greek texts and gods and culture. And so for her, it's a completely audacious move to take your cholent and put it on the table of the Greek gods in your poem and to thereby, in a really sneaky way, claim Germanness because your quintessential ethnic food is part of the Greek, part of high Greek culture. So it's kind of like a really he takes his own circuitous route in a way. So anyway, so that got me started. I thought, wow, this is an amazing poem. It's an amazing story. How might different thinkers use, not just celebrate Sabbath, and not just use it as a way to talk about how to slow down time, both very interesting, but further, how might it become a kind of stepping stone to negotiating the challenge of assimilation? How might it be a really strange way to claim assimilation, or maybe some other thinkers use it as a way to resist the demand for assimilation? And so how do people negotiate that demand specifically through the Sabbath? So that's really the question that I'm interested in, although I'm interested in the whole stoppage question also.
Yeah, so I mean, one of the things that I think brings the two together, I'm hoping, is that if you go through this dish that's being offered up, so I typically have thought, growing up a Methodist in New England, and many of you may have similar ways from different religious perspectives, but to think of it as the Sabbath as a kind of emptiness, a kind of series of rules about what you don't do. You don't, at that time, blue laws, you didn't shop. But I mean, there's a lot, you don't work, you don't do this. And I think this points us in a slightly different direction. Here is the kind of elevation of a very homely dish. It's a kind of the Sabbath as a fullness, being full of something rather than empty of other things. Mm-hmm. And that are these the things that are being offered as that negotiation? It's not the prohibition part of the Sabbath, but the fullness of the Sabbath that's transacting that connection between one, you know, the conscious pariah, mm-hmm. The conscious pariah's negotiation mm-hmm. between the two cultures in which he belongs.
Yeah, that's a great question. So there's a couple of things on this PowerPoint. Whoops, sorry. I'm all wired. There's a couple of things in the PowerPoint that speak to this and in the project. So most importantly, I think the idea of Sabbath that we inherited, at least that I grew up with, is very very much about regulation and law, sort of what you're allowed to do, what you're not allowed to do, that sort of thing. And even now, when people are reclaiming it in a more secular or modern Jewish kind of way, it tends to be about a kind of stopping the everyday mm-hmm. and enjoying your family or spending time as a community.
Right. Yeah, but I was thinking of Andrew Sullivan saying, get off your digital, he's not saying what else you should do, he's just saying don't be on your digital
right, take
tools.
A break.
And so what is that? What comes in?
Right.
Playing basketball? I mean, is it leisure? Is it...
Right. You know? So I think for a lot of people, it is just leisure, which is not to diminish leisure. We could all use some leisure. But I think what we have in the kind of received inheritance of Jewish thinkers from Heine, from Arendt, from Heine, from Rosenzweig, who I'll talk about this morning also, and A.J. Heschel, who wrote a great book called The Sabbath in the 1950s, which still reads beautifully, the idea that these different people are working with all through the tradition is the idea of Sabbath as a kind of confrontation with fullness, where the week is actually empty because it's filled with the non-meaningful. And where you have a kind of sense of plenitude is in your enjoyment of the day of the Sabbath. So from A.J. Heschel, for example, who marched with Martin Luther King at Selma, there's a lot of quotes on the next slide. I'm just assuming you can read the bits you want and get a taste for his text. I'm not going to spend time reading them, but you can get from looking at them a sense that what the Sabbath represents for Heschel is the experience of eternal time. And so the great innovation or the great contribution that he has to thinking about Sabbath is he makes it about stopping secular time and entering into the experience of eternal time.
So can you explain what that?
It's hard to explain it. So, yeah. But I will. I can say a little something about it. So, first, what I want to mention also, though, is that what he shares with Heine, as I just described him, is this incredible audacity, because the reason that Heschel wrote this book in the 1950s is it was right after the war. It was a time of great demand of assimilationism for many recently arrived Jews. It's also why, to the U.S., it's also why Arendt wrote her essay. She was responding to a similar moment and a similar set of demands. And so he wanted to write a book about how important it was to Jewish Americans to keep the Sabbath. And you would think that he would find a way to peddle that idea in a way that would find acceptance among, you know, people who were concerned about their membership in a in a recently receiving situation. And he did, but the way that he did it was by making this crazy claim that Sabbath is about divine and eternal time, and that if you skip it, if you miss it, if you absent yourself from it, what you're absenting yourself from is a religious experience. So he didn't, I'm trying to say, like, he didn't soften or secularize it in any way to make it easier to swallow. He went all out. And the idea of eternal time is that, you know, you are released from punctuality. You know, your time is, your experience for those 25 hours is differently punctuated than on a clock.
So some of this is really experiential. You're going to feel time in a different way.
A lot of it is experiential. Okay. And importantly, what it does, though, is it is the experience of it is supposed to make you aware that you're always in eternal time. You just take a day a week to experience it. Yeah, it's not like God just shows up on Saturday for you. He's always there, or eternal time is always there, subtending or transcending secular or profane time. And that once a week, in a way, the door is opened to experience it fully. And when the door is closed to it again at the end of the Saturday evening, you move back into the secular, but with the trace of the sacred coming with you. What was really important for Heschel too, and this was also audacious, and it's why he was marching with Martin Luther King, is that the experience of Sabbath, the experience of eternal time, is a really powerful reminder of the importance of equality, of the importance of freedom, of the importance of an inspirited relationship to others. So it wasn't a political book, but it had a kind of political message that he thought was continuous, that had a demand to make on how we experience the everyday.
Are those the sort of, let's call them, virtues that he pointed to? Or was he trying to pull out a variety of, because there's many, many kinds of moral spaces that you don't or you're not conscious of inhabiting, or you don't reflect on in the ordinary business of the week. But was there a reason he pointed particularly to forms of community? That's kind of an obvious one, but towards equality or freedom, or out of the many things in this basket you could have chosen, it seems like he's focusing on a particular element of a Sabbath.
So the strong, well, the strongest element is this idea of eternal time, whose in some ways principal function is this sense of plenitude, but also I think the most powerful effect that it has, whether or not you buy it religiously, you know, whether or not you're observant and believe in eternity, what it does press on you is the idea of multiple temporalities. In other words, you know, if even if you don't buy the specifics of the Jewish eternal time that he is faithful to, just reading about the experience of an alternative temporality is a way of being reminded that there are many temporalities that different people in different cultures live by, and that the one that we think of as a neutral time, you know, it's 7 in the morning, 9 in the morning, like that feels to us just like as neutral as there's air, you know?
Right.
That itself is, you know, what we used to call a social construct, and it has constitutive effects on how we understand ourselves, and to interrupt it by confronting or being reminded of an alternative is also to be reminded of alternatives more generally. Now, insofar as that 24/7 temporality that we all live in is enslaving, you know, we feel very empowered by it. Those of us who live a certain kind of life might feel very empowered by it. Others who work by the clock, maybe less so. All of us, Heschel would say, are, you know, not equally, but all of us are subjects of time, not the masters of that time. Right. Even if we feel like we're, you know, I often feel like I'm totally efficient. I've got this, you know, but especially at those moments when you feel like, you know, I am being totally productive, you know, I can rest every bit of efficiency out of my day, that's when we're least free. We feel like we're the most accomplished and the most free, but for him, that's obviously when we're least free.
I'm not sure this is on topic, so we can, but was there an outreach here to the rapid secularization of Jewish life in the post-war? So that you could still maintain a Sabbath, whether or not you're observant in other ways, that the Sabbath was, you know, is there some intent or some attempt to capture this for Jewish culture rather than just Jewish religion or law versus everyday life or something like that everyone can hold on to this rather than, you know, so that it still would hold the culture of Judaism together even without lots of disparate areas of belief.
I love that you keep using the word holding because it's a great word for this experience. So because there is a way in which when Heschel talks about the Sabbath, somewhat uniquely, he talks about it as if it was a kind of holding environment in the Winnicottian sense, right? Of sort of recollecting yourself.
Right.
And I think he even uses the phrase at one point, tent of time. You know, so the great thing about the Sabbath for him is every other Jewish holiday, he says, you have a place you have to go to and then you leave it. Like you walk into a sukkah and you leave the sukkah or you walk into synagogue or leave it or walk into the Purim festival and leave it. But Sabbath comes to you as a time and you don't go in or out to be in it.
Yeah.
He describes it as a tent of time, giving it that holding environment sort of quality, which was also a big thought in the 1950s.
Right.
Like there are a lot of things converging in that in that moment. But I think you're asking if you could get the goods of Sabbath without going to synagogue, and I think that's the question. And
church or whatever it is.
And I think
Yeah, can you experience it separated from other forms of observance or
I think that is what's interesting about Heschel, because he is trying to give us a kind of cultural Judaism that doesn't necessarily come necessarily with religiosity.
Right.
It could. Mm-hmm. But it does require, as does Judaism in general, which I think is one of the great things about Judaism, it does require phenomenological experience.
Mm-hmm.
It's not enough to say, okay, I'm just gonna, you know, the Andrew Sullivan thing, I'm just unplugging my phone for the day.
Right.
It's not a bad start, but it's not enough because the rationale of all the rules is that conforming to them, and I'm not recommending that we necessarily follow all the rules, but it is interesting that the rationale of all the rules is that conforming to them is not the purpose. The conforming to them creates the experience.
Can you talk about some of those rules? Like we haven't really talked about.
We can talk about the rules.
One or two, or
yeah. So, well, the rules are, one way to summarize the rules is that you're not supposed to do things where human agency or a sense of sovereignty is the mechanism. So you don't turn, you don't use electricity, you don't turn lights on mm-hmm. and off, you don't drive a car, you have to walk, you have to live according to the lightness and darkness of the world. You know, so when it gets dark, you go to sleep, you don't stay up for three more hours doing other things, because, you know, ideally, I mean, I'm perfectly well aware people use timers and all these other things. So, but like the idea of it is that you enter a different time, and so you are not sovereign over punctual time through using mechanisms mm-hmm, that mm-hmm. enable that sovereignty. Right. Again, I'm perfectly well aware that people do this, but the idea is, but even those people who are observant, obviously that's why they take advantage of those mechanisms, are doing other things, like having Sabbath dinners, saying prayers, singing songs, you right. know, so there's an experiential dimension that they also have. But the biggest things that people think of when they think about Sabbath are all the things you're not allowed to do, the prohibitions. There are like 39 melachot, labors, that you're not allowed to do on the Sabbath. Mm-hmm. And of course, once you name them, once the rabbis finish with them, they've spun out to several thousand things that you're not allowed to do, you know, because everything has to be like very detailed. Mm-hmm. So there are many, many things like the ones I just mentioned. Of course, right. you don't work. But what's really beautiful, I think, about both Heine's poetry and Heschel's reading of the day is that they focus, as we were saying before, on the fullness of the experience of being in the Sabbath. And the fullness of the experience comes from the food and the... I refer to Heine's, I didn't give you all the stanzas, but I refer to his poem as creating a kind of sensorial synagogue, because he talks about like what the candles smell like and how mm-hmm. the wine tastes mm-hmm. and how the clothes that you put on for the Sabbath feel. And so it's just, it's a very phenomenological experience right. in its fullness, which is made possible by stripping away all the mm-hmm. things that we think of not as distractions, but as our purpose. Mm-hmm. Once you strip the kind of that purpose away, you can experience this right. fullness in this sensorial way.
Right. Interesting. So, is there a political dimension in these rules? I mean, you're talking about a kind of experiential dimension, a theological dimension. Mm-hmm. Is there something that I mean, you could say that certainly assimilation or non-assimilation is a deeply political question that mm-hmm. we're very conscious of mm-hmm. at the moment, and certainly Arendt was a driving concern for her all through her work. But are there other dimensions of our social and political world that are highlighted by the Sabbath, are made distinct by the Sabbath?
I didn't come yet to the third person who's Rosenzweig. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if we're there yet in the PowerPoint. I've lost track. Yeah, we are.
Yeah, I think so.
So let me say a little bit about him. Mm-hmm. There's a part of him. So, and he's writing in the, did I put it states? Yeah, so in the early 20th century, he's writing. He wrote a book called The Star of Redemption, which is a difficult but rewarding read. But in addition to writing a very opaque kind of Hegel-style work of philosophy, which is what Star of Redemption is, he was also, I know there's a lot there, but I'll just tell you what it says very quickly. He also founded a lair house, which is like an adult night school for people interested in learning about Judaism. He worked with Martin Buber on that. And his argument in the lair house materials, not in the Star of Redemption, but he had more accessible materials that he wrote for everyday people. And his argument there was that there were two ways of responding to the challenge of assimilation. And one was the one that a lot of Jewish leaders took, which was to really emphasize law, to talk about Jewish law, Jewish requirements, Jewish mm-hmm. prohibitions, mm-hmm. Because that gives you what feels like a really firm marker of where you're at in relationship to the mainstream society. So if you have your law, you know where you right. stand.
So law is a kind of boundary between you and that.
Exactly, yeah. A boundary, a marker, which it is, you know. That. Yeah. So he kind of understood that, But his argument for the educational program that he promoted at the Lehr House was that the most important thing was to reinvent Judaism as life. In a way, this is a very Hegelian idea, right? That law is dead unless it's turned into some sort of vitalism. Right. But he juxtaposed the idea of contesting assimilation through law, well, he identified that as the mistaken move, and said, you know, Judaism as life, which is the plenitude, not the prohibitive, is the more promising route. And you might have noticed in the previous slide, too, from Heschel, it's about enjoyment. It's about tasting food and tasting eternity. That metaphor of taste travels from the one to the other. And here, too, this is what Rosenzweig often would talk about, what happens at the table, at the Sabbath table or at the Passover table, where everyone relates to each other as equals, he says. One of the things he loves about the Passover Seder is that that what happens at the Seder is driven by the child instead of being driven by the father. So, you know, we're talking about a certain person in a certain period in the 1920s writing. But so he has certain assumptions that he brings to it. But he does, you know, what happens at the Passover Seder is instead of it being the father at the head of the table like every other meal, the father's at the head of the table was totally oriented by the questions of the youngest. And then he says, you know, and later in the evening when everyone's had enough to drink, it becomes completely, everything's topsy-turvy. And that's like the creative, revolutionary experience of sitting at the Passover table. And he says the Sabbath table is like that as well.
Right, so the normal hierarchies are no longer in play. I mean, it's deliberately non-hierarchical or anti-hierarchical in some way.
There is something anti-hierarchical about it. And he also points out, let's see if I have this on the next slide. No, this is maybe some detail that's too much for us, but we could go to this. So he also points out that Sabbath is connected to the Exodus story. That's why he makes those analogies between the Passover Seder and Sabbath. And he reminds us that the reason that we have Sabbath in the Hebrew Bible, the original commandment, is linked not to all of us, the Andrew Sullivans, the Judith Shulevitzes, the me's, the you's. It's for the maidservants and the, what's the other word they use? I can't remember. Well, for the servants and maidservants of the household and for the animals, the beasts of the field. And then it's for the rest of us. But the most important thing is that there are people who, in the absence of this emancipatory experience once a week would never stop working and are not in an empowered enough position to take time for themselves. Time has to be, in a way, given to them. As indeed, in the end, it has to be for all of us.
Right, but in the Sabbath, then, with those rules of the Sabbath, they don't have to ask for it, nor does it get to be given by someone. It's actually completely. The space you're entered into equally when you come
into. It takes you over. Right? It takes over the household, and so there's no question about being empowered enough or asking or waiting or
giving the gift of.
Receiving a gift, which is also a kind of lovely inequality. So instead, the Sabbath descends on the household, and everyone knows what that means. Right. You know, historically in the Hebrew Bible, that's the way it's. And it is interesting that it includes the beasts of the field, as it said, so that, you know, you can see one of several moments of non-human-centric concerns in the Hebrew Bible.
Interesting. We have only about 10 more minutes, so
let's get to the good
stuff. Reason I say this because Bonnie and I were determined to get to this one particularly wonderful idea that I think is implicit in some of what is we've been talking about, but the way the kind of political space opened up through the Sabbath and the mechanisms of that through.
So this is my mission. It's to remind people of the fact that in the Hebrew Bible there are actually three sabbatical requirements and not just one. So the one that we all know is the weekly Sabbath, which you've all decided to share with me today. Thank you. The other two are every 7 years, there's supposed to be a land sabbatical, and every 49 years, there's supposed to be a debt sabbatical, which is slave emancipation, the emancipation of debt slaves. And they are connected. They refer to each other in the Hebrew Bible, and one of the reasons that we see this tracing and retracing with reference even to books that are written only about the weekly Sabbath of the ideas of freedom and equality is because they come together. So I find it very interesting for us, especially at this particular moment where inequality, I think, is an appropriately big concern for our society, to think about how, you know, a lot of people are talking about slowing down time and the importance of Sabbath, but experiencing it as a kind of amputated part of something that actually has three parts and that only works with all three parts.
I mean, one of the things, I just want, I don't mean to interrupt, but one of the things that when you got rid of the blue laws in New England, you know, then some people were free to experience the Sabbath as a fullness and as you know, a moment of eternal time, but many, many more people were now had to work. They were scheduled to work on a Sunday, and therefore you had to work, and they didn't have the option of saying, no, I'm not going to work on Sunday.
Right.
So it actually enforced a kind of inequality around the Sabbath that I don't think anyone had anticipated. You know, it was more like being free.
You were
to
now
purchase.
Free to shop, but
now
somebody had to be behind the counter.
Right, exactly. No, but that's what it was.
And what we
so
know from Heschel is being free to shop is not free anyway,
right.
Because that's not
right.
the kind of, that's not eternal time, I
right.
can tell
and
you
that's,
that.
That's what's so striking to me about your comment about the fact that it opens the space for everyone to be relieved of their duties. It's a great equalizer in that sense, and so you're talking about another dimension of equality, or other dimensions of equality that the Sabbath is actually very much
enmeshed
concerned
in.
With.
Enmeshed in. And so we think about all the rules that make the Sabbath a day of rest, and so we think of the Sabbath as a day of rest, but unless we remember that in the Hebrew Bible, that weekly Sabbath is together with the land sabbatical, also called a Sabbath.
And what does that
in
mean?
Hebrew
I'm sorry, I just don't know what
it means that every 7 years you have to lend if you own land and you cultivate the land, that every 7 years you need to let the land go fallow. And you're not allowed to harvest. Things will grow on it. Obviously, if you plant it for 6 years in a row, and the seventh year when you don't plant on it, things will grow on it. You are not allowed to harvest what grows on it. What grows on it without having been planted is there for the poor to glean. And so that's the rule of land sabbatical every 7 years, and then every seven times 7 years, which we also have to count, there's slave emancipation, which is called Jubilee, which is also called the Sabbath of Sabbaths. So there's weekly Sabbath, there's every 7 year Sabbath, and then there's every 49 year Sabbath of Sabbaths. I think the other thing that's really interesting about these three, which are, as I say, connected, and so that when you're having your weekly Sabbath, you are reminded also of the land sabbatical and the death sabbaticals to come. You don't experience them, like if you're doing it properly, as it were, you wouldn't experience any one of them without being re-impressed into the demands of the others. But the most important thing is that they all involve counting. So in the case of the land sabbatical, you count 7 years to get there, and you're commanded to count, and you count 7 times 7, 49 years. And that's a communal requirement that everybody do the count, like every day. I was saying earlier to Cass that when, I don't know if you guys remember, but when the American hostages were held in Iran in, was it 79, Ted Koppel had that nightly news show, and he used to start it during the time that they were being held in Iran. Every night he would say, today is day 123 of the hostages being in Iran, today is day 189 of, and every night I would be like, oh my, he's counting, like he's doing the Jewish count, which I think he was. So you have to do that count, and so I think one of the interesting things is to think about what that work of counting is doing. Mm-hmm. It's kind of interesting, like you could, maybe you could say they didn't have calendars then, but I think they did. or they could have a counter, like a guy whose job it is to count. But the requirement is that the whole community counts. And so there's two possible reasons for that. I'm sure there's 100 possible reasons for that, but the two I'll mention is one, that it's community forming. You know, I mean, I think when all of us sat in front of the TV and heard today's 183 of the hostages being in Iran, that had a kind of interpolative effect on us. But the other is that if you give it to somebody to do, and that somebody knows that when you get to the seventh year, all the rich landowners have to leave their land to be gleaned by the poor, that somebody could be paid off to not get to seven quite so fast, right. You know? And so the idea of the community counting is that everyone in the community is counting and there's no cheating, which is an important thing to know that you can have counting with no cheating, I think. and so that's a kind of self-governance mechanism, both in terms of community formation and also in terms of accountability, that's built into the idea. And then, unfortunately, though, I think it also has a kind of bittersweet side effect, which is obviously if you're counting your sevens and you're yourself a slave and you know you're waiting till 49, you know, the image I have there is more like, you know, the guy in the prison right. cell who's marking the things and crossing them off. So it, you know, nothing Jewish comes with only the good stuff. There's always this kind of that goes with it. So that's that moment right there.
So I don't know whether you've given any thought to how some of these aspects can the aspects of counting, the forms of equality, mm-hmm. the forms of shared responsibility and accountability, you know, how these are part of the Sabbath but can extend out into everyday life. I mean, so that they're not ideals that are you know, I know that you mentioned the word trace, that the trace of eternal time would, I mean, so do we, we really want it only to be a trace of equality. So how are
you know, a trace of equality would be really good.
But even that would be good.
So I mean, you know,
How do some of these ideas? How are they meant to actually shape ordinary time and ordinary social interaction and other forms of? I mean, as reminders or as practices. I mean, the counting is a practice, and it only doesn't happen only on the Sabbath. It mm-hmm. couldn't, or else you might not get to the Sabbath, right? But mm-hmm. you're so that. But all
although
these other,
although there's different kinds of, interestingly, yeah. I think with a lot of this, you know, one way that you can think about this idea of sabbatical or eternal time is that everything is the same, but you, it's done in a different way. So like we count every day, we count money, we count change, yeah. we count what we can afford, we, you know, we count who counts and who doesn't in our little social world, right. and then, but at the same time, if at the same time, like really think about it, if at the same time every day you wake up thinking, 5 more days, 4 more days, 3 more days, that isn't nothing, you know, mm-hmm. if what you're counting towards is the experience of Sabbath and that more egalitarian, in the context of a more egalitarian understanding of Sabbath. It isn't nothing.
Right. The rabbis the week towards that endpoint,
it makes
right?
Because
you're counting down
it.
To it.
Yes,
right?
You're
yeah.
counting down to it every week, and you're emerging from it every week. Mm-hmm. So Rosenzweig in particular was very keen to make clear, contrary to the more legalistic understanding of the Sabbath, that what was important about the Sabbath was not its discreteness from mm-hmm. the everyday, but the fact that it bleeds into the everyday, mm-hmm. both in terms of, you know, recovering from it, as it were, and then immediately on the cusp of that coming out of it, starting to be counting and orienting
yeah.
towards it right. again. I just wanted to tell you the funny story about this one sort of Talmudic debate where the rabbi's been a fair amount of time talking about what to do if you've been, if you're lost in the desert, and Judith Shulevitz tells the story in her book. If you're lost in the desert all by yourself, and you don't know what day it is, and you don't want to violate the Sabbath, what do you do? And so they have this whole debate about like, well, should you just say, okay, today is the Sabbath, and start counting from that day, you know, or should you, from that day, count to seven?
To the Sabbath, right.
To the Sabbath, right? And Shulevitz points out, you know, like a lot of these crazy examples that the rabbis come up with, you know, they don't spend 2 seconds thinking, oh my God, this guy's lost in the desert. What's he going to do? You know, it's all about like the Sabbath, which is a really good point. But it does also position, you know, open up that Rosenzweigian question about, you know, how you are always either in the Sabbath or counting towards
right.
the Sabbath. And so which one you start from when you're in the desert is a question that makes that very static. But if you think of it in more kind of relational terms,
right.
you can see how that's the motion of I'm starting to say Jewish life, but really it should be the motion of any good life, because Sabbath, of course, is not only a Jewish idea, it's an Islamic idea, it's a Christian idea. I'm just working with the Jewish sources, but it's available for many.
Right. Since we have just a little bit of time, is there anything we didn't get to that you want to make sure we offer up to?
I think we did it.
Okay.
I think we did
it. All right.
It.
We have 15 minutes for questions, and we have microphones. And since the Chicago Humanities Festival events are taped, we would really appreciate it if you would wait for the mic.
My name is Ruth, and I'm not Jewish. I came because I was interested in the Sabbath overall, but I found this very interesting. You mentioned that the Sabbath is a three-part concept, and the 7 years and 49 years, with the seven, I believe, being the fallow period and the 49 emancipation.
Yeah.
How do you translate it into the modern world where most of us don't have slaves and don't farm?
So, you know, I have an easy answer for professors like me, which is we do get sabbaticals. And those sabbaticals, in a way, are the purpose, their purpose is to reduce the temporality of everyday productivity in order to allow something generative and intellectual to happen. As soon as someone gives me a sabbatical, I'm going to finish this book.
But doesn't that turn it on its head, Bonnie? Isn't that turn it on its head a little? Because now you have to produce the book on your sabbatical.
No, I know,
You are not lying fallow and gathering up the...
No, it's true. But it's a different... It is a different pace of thinking that allows something generative to happen. And so that's one place where we have it, and it's a very small place where we have it. You know, culturally speaking, you know, very few of us have access to that. So I think, you know, I use the word amputation, which is a harsh word for what we have done to the Sabbath, so that we only have the one and not the other two. And so that's meant to suggest that it is not an easy thing to go just institute the other two or find them in the modern world. It really is about recognizing what we have and what people are starting to turn to for a slow time is an amputated remnant of something that had... that was nested in a very egalitarian and socially conscientious practice. I guess the thing I didn't say that I would love to say is that the way that I see this working is I see it as a recognition in an ancient culture, and this isn't the only one. There are other ancient cultures that, by the way, that had things called blank slate legislations where you just like stop, you know, the acquisition and start all over again, or forgive debts. You know, and of course, we have bankruptcy as a little remnant of that. What was I going to say? It was a recognition that no matter what kind of a society you live in, what kind of an economy you run by, inequality accretes over time. You know, it's just, I don't want to say it's in the nature of things, because there are economies that are structured, better structured to prevent that from happening, but over time, social, cultural, or financial capital is acquired.
Right.
And so the every 7 years and the every 49 years is a kind of built-in recognition that even if you're trying to have a very conscientious communal formation in which no one is too much at the mercy of anyone else, that things start to accrete over time. And so you have these moments where you just say, okay, we're all going back to where we were in some symbolic or actual or, you know, more or less actual way. And that's something that I think, you know, we have quite a distance to go, especially right now, and I'm not pretending otherwise. But, you know, that's something to think about. I think that's something that all of us individually and communally can find ways to do, not necessarily these specific ways, but ways to do.
It also strikes me that though, mostly because these are not about individual practices that are enjoyed with family and friends, they're about practices that the community is enjoined to do. So it's not like some of you can leave your field fallow and the other ones can busily accumulate while right. you're not planting. I mean, it's enforced across the board, right. and then that's a kind of how, you know, what forms of joined sabbatical action could right. one imagine in a modern society?
And, you know, this is the period where they still have the death penalty for Sabbath violations, so...
Yeah.
When she says enforce, we're talking about yeah. enforce. But yes, it is, it's a communal and public commitment to live a certain kind of life. Mm-hmm. And as I was saying, in the context of no longer having control of the mechanisms of self-governance, living as minorities in a majority society that doesn't live according to any of these laws, I think all of these thinkers are looking for ways not just to make sure people remember Saturday, but that they remember the equality demand that mm-hmm. Sabbath comes with, the creation demand, like that we be creative in the world, that we find ways to not just succumb to the routine and the repetition of the everyday. So all of these little sort of chestnuts remain to be made operational by us. But not just as individuals. Mm-hmm. It's never just an individual mm-hmm. project, but it's never not an individual project either.
Right. I just wanted to ask you about the relationship of this to the concept of teshuvah, of renewal on a daily basis, mm-hmm. on a weekly basis mm-hmm. with Shabbat, and on a yearly basis with the high holidays and turning of a new year, and how you feel that the two are linked.
So thank you very much. That's a great question. So Rosenzweig is your thinker. He's really interested in the Jewish calendar and the cyclicality, which is eternal time rather than linear, which is human time, and the cyclicality of that Jewish calendar. In other words, how the week, you know, how Passover comes every year, Sabbath comes every week, and he's the one who made me attentive to the counting as part of, that's part of what makes the calendar go around, right? He doesn't talk about these three registers of Sabbath that I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why yet. I think your question, in a way, is inviting me to think more about why he doesn't. Does he think that the cycle is enough? But I don't know. He just doesn't. He talks about everything, and he doesn't talk about this. And there isn't anything in his work that would make me think that he's in some way hostile to the creativity or equality demands that I've been talking about. I don't mm-hmm. think that's it. But somehow it's just not something that comes up for him. So it may be that the 7 years and the 49 years are not within the year. Mm-hmm. And what holds the Star of Redemption together is the cycle of the year and then its repetition every year. And the every seventh year of the land sabbatical and every 49th year are themselves suspensions of this yearly calendar, which he thinks is the center of, you know, Jewish existence and Jewish spirituality. So that might be why he doesn't talk about it. Does that answer the question a little bit? So how do they relate? You know, I think that poses the question of how do they relate. In a strange way, they seem like an interruption of this perpetuity. But in another way, just like Sabbath, I'm saying, is not an interruption of the week, but an intensification of the week, maybe we should think about how the 7 years and the 49 years are themselves intensifiers and markers of what's going on every year in themselves. Hmm. That's really a great question for me. Thank you.
There's a woman right here on the end who's had her hand up for a couple questions.
Hi.
Hi. I'd like to make a couple of points, if I may.
Sure.
We haven't talked about the joy of the Sabbath. And I think in the Havdalah service at the end of the Sabbath, we talk about the separation of the sacred and the profane.
Yes.
And the joy versus a different kind of joy on Shabbat. Mm-hmm. And I would posit that those who really observe the Sabbath look forward to it with joy.
Absolutely.
And not, mm-hmm. they look forward to it as what they get to do, mm-hmm. not what they don't get to
I
do.
I agree.
Or what they're prohibited from
I agree.
Doing. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a really strong element to discuss about the
Absolutely.
Sabbath.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
My other point is, if you don't mind the second one, I grew up behind the Iron Curtain, where Sabbath was not allowed. I couldn't go to synagogue. I'm talking when I was a child. Mm-hmm. My parents had to work. Being a Jew was not advisable. My parents had to figure out a way, and I'm not saying we were extremely observant, uh-huh. but they needed to teach us Judaism somehow. Mm-hmm. And they had to find ways in which to bring Sabbath into our lives. And they did. I baked a challah with my mother on Thursday evening in preparation of the Sabbath. I had my own little table. I had my own little tablecloth. I had my own candlesticks, which I still have to this day. And I think there are ways to make it meaningful, not just because you go to synagogue or you walk instead of mm-hmm. driving.
Yeah, yeah.
And I just wanted to point that out. To this day, there are things that I do on the Sabbath that may not have any meaning to anybody else, but it comes from my home and mm-hmm. my mother, and it's meaningful to me, and hopefully my children.
Yeah. That's really beautiful. Thank you very much for sharing yeah. that with us. So I want to say that when we were talking about plenitude and the sensorial synagogue, those were fancy ways of saying what you just said. you know, in the Heine poem, he talks about the smell of the candles, the smell of the spices, even with reference to the Havdalah, the burning smell of the flame being put out in the wine, which is part of the ritual of the end of ending Sabbath. And you don't blow out the candle, you put it out in the wine, and that gives off a very particular smell, which I can tell you I have not smelled since you were probably baking with your mother, but I can still smell it yeah. now when I talk about it. So those are really indelible memories because they're sensorial memories. You remember probably the dough on your hand, the smell of it. I'll tell you that the challah usually has three braids, and I would argue that the three braids are for the three registers of Sabbath. Mm-hmm. And that braiding, which is a motif throughout Jewish life and Jewish law, I think that threeness has that mm-hmm. particular connotation mm-hmm. for Jews, different, let's say, from the Christian Trinity, but very powerful within the Jewish tradition. So I appreciate your point, and I agree with you. I think mm-hmm. the sense of anticipation and joy is not from, oh, thank God I can get off this treadmill, but mm-hmm. more, you know, which is what we're doing all week long, but more that they're, you know, I'm going to be with friends, I'm going to be in this different time, I'm going to be with God for many people, mm-hmm. And that's a plenitude. That's mm-hmm. not the deprivations of no lights, no cars, no whatever. Those are like the guardrails so that you can experience mm-hmm. something. Mm-hmm. They're not the point. They're the mise en scène for something to happen. And what happens, they're not the mm-hmm. sufficient conditions of it happening, because you can keep your mind busy with crap all week long, right. all throughout this day, even mm-hmm. while you're not doing any of those things. They're not the sufficient conditions, but they are the necessary conditions, it is argued within religious Judaism. I think what we've been suggesting is that, you know, there are many ways you can do it, not necessarily impressing yourself into full observance. And I think what you just said is one illustration of that. So thank you.
It's one of the reasons why in all the religions the concept of Sabbath has declined is because of the concept of recreation and play and amusement that has arisen, say, in the last 400, 500 years for the ordinary individuals that didn't exist, because all they had was work and rest.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, yes. Yeah. if I understood your question correctly, I would not necessarily think 400 or 500 years. I talk about a maybe shorter time span and talk about how certainly from the time that Heschel was writing that play and leisure have been turned into a business. And
this is a huge post-war phenomenon is the industry of leisure and the actual active production, even on government fronts, to producing spaces of leisure, supporting activities of even parks. These were all these activities that were actually, but they weren't really about leisure from that perspective. They were about exercise. I mean, like filling it
something
with some
productive.
other capacity is being exercised.
Yeah.
And then it really became passive It was much more active leisure that was being promoted at the time, and then it's, you know, turned into what it is now that you recognize.
Yeah, well, there's that, and then on the other side, there's the topic that we began with, which is the demand for assimilation, the nervousness about being different publicly in a society that has historically tolerant by comparison with other societies, but still has a strong social demand for conformity, especially on directed at new immigrants. So in the 50s and the 60s, you know, if you were the child of people who had come over from Europe, you weren't eager to be doing anything different on Saturday than every other kid in the neighborhood would be doing. Mm-hmm. And there were reasons for that. But what was lost was not just, I guess what we've been talking about today is how much is lost and how audaciously crazy were the people like Heschel, who were in a great, good way, I'm saying this, to Heschel, who starts his book saying, I'm writing this book because I'm concerned about Jewish assimilation and I want to bring, you know, create a holding for them, you know, so that people understand, you know, what's worth holding on to. And then gives the most unassimilated, improbable arguments that you could possibly give about what Sabbath means. He doesn't code it in anything recognizable that would be recognizable or accessible to a secular Jew. He makes it as alien and remote as it is and should be in order for it to do the kind of work that he's hoping it will do, the kind of work that puts him on the road to Selma with Martin Luther King. Mm-hmm. So I think that's amazing. But it's so much, his task is made more difficult by the industrialization of ledger, let's say, by turning into an industry. But that wasn't exactly what he was worrying about yet, partly because it was just starting to happen. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure he really understood at that point when he wrote that book what he was soon going to be up against. Mm-hmm.
This is going to be our last question for this program.
This is a parallel question that we just asked. And isn't there a larger philosophical point being made as well as the wonderful analysis of the particulars of the Sabbath, which ultimately lead to this concept you quickly went over of downtime, of being out of time, of not confusing leisure with shopping or playing tennis, of having a mangiapiano. You talked about the slow eating, the purpose of getting together as an Italian and a Jew is to spend time with the family, right? Mm-hmm. Theology isn't discussed, but being a human being is discussed. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if there isn't a much larger message that you could that reaches out to a larger audience than the particular theological analysis as you've done.
So did you just tell me that I'm doing what I'm saying Heschel did? that there's something more accessible and available to people that I could be saying, and instead I'm kind of giving the crazy idea.
Not a crazy idea.
Okay.
But it's an idea that's open to a larger audience.
Yeah. Can I ask you what you would say? What do you think that idea is? Like, just so I know what's behind your question. The importance of being lazy. You know, I will tell you, I'm so glad you put it that way. Thank you so much, because we're being taped. Okay. I was going to say something personal. Well, I'll take a chance. So I have a son, and he's a wonderful, very hardworking guy. But, you know, when he was in high school and he was a teenage boy, it was very hard to motivate him to do his schoolwork and other, even the fact that I'm saying I had to motivate him, so already you know. So, and I didn't, I mean, I failed. And you know, these are life stages and you go through them, and of course he's gone on to other and great things. But what I have learned, I don't know if it coincides with this project or if I've learned it from the project. I've learned it in time for his younger sister who's still home, that I have a great respect now for adolescents who defend their right to be lazy. I see that not as a sign, I'm ashamed to say, sometimes I thought it was potentially a sign of bad character or of something that really needed correction. Now I see it as a great positive sign that they have a very good sense of the importance of refusal. And I respect it. A little belatedly for him, but, you know, better late than never, right? So, yeah, I think that is really important. And I think you can see that. Maybe I could use an academic term for this, which is there's a kind of autoimmunity always in Judaism, which is to say, you know, it looks like you're all about the law, but then there's this anarchic dimension, or it looks like you're all about the rules, and then there's this freedom dimension, you know, or it looks like you're all about social status, but then there's this radical equality. It's kind of always that double move is always in there, And so, yeah, I think there are a lot of rules, and they have all the purposes that we described and all the rest, but fundamentally, you know, it's an ancient society that required that people be productive to sustain life. You know, you couldn't, like, just hang around. You know, everybody had to play a part in the reproduction of life. But built into it is this refusal to do it. And I think it's... I think we're at a moment where remembering the ancient and contemporary need for refusal is a very important one. So, thank you.